Adam, can I ask you the first question before Ben helps me out? And ask you basically to explain to everybody here in as clear a way as you can, what is dimensionalism?
You're going to ask me that.
Well, I mean, it's inevitable, isn't it?
Okay. Right, well, you've got traditional 3D, three dimensions, where you've got three planes, so you've got height, width, and depth. And within the fourth dimension, you've got the element of time as well, or the passage of time. You're basically trying to kind of capture an object or a composition within the concepts of time and space. You're not relying on the traditional two-point perspective. Say a cubist artist would capture a table with a violin and a bottle of water by standing in one position, painting it, moving around to see the other side of it, again on the two-dimensional canvas, so flattening the shape in two dimensions. Within dimensionalism, you are creating a composition in dimensional space. You have the elements of 3D involved, but the fourth dimension, if you like, time and space, the viewer is the catalyst as he moves from left to right or backwards and forwards, where, depending on the position, the painting reacts to the viewer's whereabouts. Also, elements like the time of day, the light and the shadow, you're also able to overlap other concepts in terms of traditional two-dimensional isms. You could have cubism overlapping with fauvism, overlapping with symbolism, overlapping with abstraction, overlapping with expressionism. So as you move around a painting, what could initially start off as figurative dissolve or morph into abstract, or at the same time have symbolism. It's a lot like you have traditional music genres like jazz and rock and roll and hip-hop, and then the advent of the sampling, the digital technology, you're able to sample musics and overlap. You know, you could overlap hip-hop with, I don't know, jazz, or classical with another beat, where you merge the kind of genres. The same within dimensionalism, you're taking traditional concepts, even conceptualism, you know, you can add conceptual thinking to a piece.
I'm interested in this idea of kind of the way you might be able to layer cubism, fauvism, futurism. They all have, I mean, particularly cubism and futurism, have quite different attitudes to the viewer. And I think you do it very well, but I don't think it's easy to do. I don't think you do it in the same way every time. And I just wondered if you could speak about that a little bit. I mean, just to clarify what you already know, cubism, as you said, has this idea of a fixed viewer, i.e. the artist, looking at a table with some things on it from here, and then synthesizing it with a viewpoint from here, multiple viewpoints of perspective, bringing the thing into being. Futurism is slightly different, because futurism is this idea of potential disintegration of everything in flux in front of you. Actually, you as the viewer are still in the same place, regardless of what's happening in terms of the fragmentation of the image. And it might even be worth just looking at something like this one and just talking through this one. Is that something we could do? Mm. I mean, because it seems to me it's quite, a starting point might be a kind of cubist methodology where you have these 2, 3, 4 viewpoints. There's a kind of high viewpoint, a low viewpoint. But you have mixed into it a kind of suggestion of things not quite holding in the center. You know, the center won't hold. And in fact, with this one, a kind of transparency, which you're playing with this kind of leaky boat idea. Tell us about how you think through that and how you resolve it. I'm interested in this resolution. Does it feel like that you're trying to resolve it? It's not just a question of borrowing a bit from here, mashing it up with that, is it? You've got to try and keep the center holding somehow, but threatening to break apart.
Yes. In relation to cubism and futurism, I was talking to you earlier about how previous concepts of time theory and eternalism in theory and time, where time is continuous, and within futurism, there's the kind of the actualism, the existence of time, the now,
Yes, there's this idea of duration.
Yes. I'm a keen fan of the new kind of Perdurance theory, where time is constant, but an object exists continuously, but within its lifespan of time, it's sometimes more visible than other periods, or it disappears at some points or reappears, but it still has that constant existence. So within this, if you look on it straight on, you're looking at an image, as you move around it, form and space gets distorted. Sometimes it disappears, sometimes it changes shape, but it still kind of exists within the composition. So you kind of have to account for that with the kind of distortion of it, and what you can play with, if it kind of, if you can use that to advantage of the within the image. For example, you look at this one straight on, he's got the harpoon pushing holes into the boat. As you move around, you get the kind of the expressionism in dimensional space, where the harpoon's bending from the force of him pushing. So you're playing with that language of using kind of the abstraction element to give it expressionist element, to give it the symbolist element of him, the feeling of him pushing. So like an expressionist artist would kind of, I don't know, you know, in two dimensions scratch into something like a line or something to give it that energy, whereas you can play with the kind of the form as well to give it that accentuation of movement, if you like.
I'm also interested in the fact that it's a well-worn art historical subject, the Ship of Fools, and I hope you've all seen the little label, you know, as if you're in a kind of civic art museum. It's perfected, this idea,
very true.
You know, that this is a kind of a throwback to kind of 1930s museum display. So it's beautifully done. Talk to us about the theme a bit, and what the theme means to you. Is this your sort of critique of capitalism or something?
I was going to get a bit political, but I wasn't going to cheapen it really with politics. But initially, it would have been Edward Miliband at the front with a kind of like a sickle and scythe with his Marxist ideologies. Yeah. You'd have like a couple of Etonians, you know, the what's his name, Cameron, the other one, rowing in the wrong direction. You'd have Farage at the back, pissing into the wind, into his face. But I'm not given the time of, you know, space for doing that. So I made it a bit more symbolic with, you know, you got the one chap, trying to catch a fish, but putting holes in the boat. The other bloke trying to bail the water out of the boat, but putting the water back in. And the other bloke basically being sick in the other bucket. So, but within the bucket, you've got that kind of symbolism of the wave within that space. Whereas around the boat, you've got the waves as well. It's kind of just playing with dimensions as well, but in a kind of a visual thing. But I think it's such a great subject. I think Goya was one of the first people. It goes back, you know, hundreds of years, the amount of artists. I didn't look at who'd done it until after I'd finished it. Then I kind of Googled it. Hopefully no one had done anything similar.
Coming back to this idea of time, duration, talk to us about this a bit, and maybe we can look at the cycle ones now. They're a kind of good lead in to this idea of kind of duration. I mean, he's coming up the hill, is that right? And he's really sort of struggling. So you're playing around with the dimension of time. He could be going down the hill, but he seems to be struggling anyway. He's kind of coming out of the saddle, if it's a he. What Henri Bergson used to say, the philosopher used to say, very famous philosopher in his day, in 1896 he wrote this thing that the cubists read, he wrote it in French, 1896, Matter and Memory. And he was interested in trying to philosophize this idea of depiction of time. It's a difficult thing to do, to depict time. But something that you do very well, I think, your work does very well, is just kind of stretch a moment just to the point where it might break, and without letting it recoil. And what Bergson was keen to do was make a distinction between the act of creation in time and the way our memory has already made something. So when you said you hadn't looked at the Ship of Fools, at the same time, obviously, you're conscious, aren't you? Like, we're all conscious. There's a collective consciousness of what a ship of fools looks like.
Mm.
So there are that's a kind of mashup in itself, isn't it? Of kind of dilute layers of kind of an image that is already there. Bergson talked about memory in relation to time. And I just wondered if I could draw you on this at all. Do much cycling yourself? This is a memory of a kind of difficult cycle ride up Ditchling Beacon? Or
you paint what you know. Mm-hmm. Paint who you are. Mm-hmm. I think it's Jackson Pollock or someone said it. An artist should paint themselves as who they are.
Or Kooning maybe, yeah.
Was it him? Mm-hmm. Someone like that. And yeah, so I paint from life and what I experience. With that life experience, you absorb feelings and emotions and you can put that. Mm. I mean, not that I've been on the boat like that, but like you say, the collective conscious of that experience of, you know, the Ship of Fools analogy. Cool. This is my first Picasso reference, by the way. But
is it going to be your last?
Yes. No, well, Picasso, depending on the subject matter, he would paint the style which best suited it. These two came from wanting to make a kind of a dimensional animation for their lenticular. Mm. So how would you animate a dimensional piece of movement within frames?
Mm.
You'd have to do the frames like a traditional animation cell, but in 3D to overlap them. So I had to work all that out and then get them photographed in a kind of a panoramic to overlap. So it was kind of a working out the mathematics and the logistics of doing that to get the forms to kind of represent those shapes, the both extremities from left to right.
Can I just take you back to your materials again? Because this, I think this is fascinating. But in terms of your original, which is cardboard, wasn't it? Essentially, you're working on cardboard. And then you went back, you've gone back to using cardboard again, but in a dimensionalist, under a dimensionalist code.
Yes.
So what's the reasoning behind that? The work's actually just straight down on the second floor.
It's more of a kind of, just to challenge myself, like, you kind of an artist, you know, go back on previous themes or relationships with how they work. My initial journey with cardboard was working on the streets. I was painting on it because I couldn't afford canvases, so I was painting on bits of found cardboard. When I went into a gallery situation, I was using the cardboard again, but within expressionism, where I'd be tearing it, stapling it, getting the roughness of it, to give a kind of a feeling with the paint, to get that emotional sense with it.
Now, you were anti-market at one point because you then left the works actually on the street, didn't you? I mean, you were pretty much...
Yes.
So you were an urban artist in spirit, in a sense, and you were... I mean, you weren't of the movement, but you weren't a part of the movement, in a sense. What was your relationship to the movement in those early days?
I was just doing my own thing, really.
Mm.
And...
You weren't conscious of the wider movement at the time, or you were conscious of it? Right?
I was doing it for self-expressionism, for expressing myself, wanting to paint. I had a day job as a designer. Every day, someone would be behind my shoulder telling me what to do, how to make this, how to do that. At the end of each day, I just let off that tension of wanting to make something for myself, so I'd just be painting and leaving it on the streets. It kind of stems from my past as a graffiti writer, where you go and paint a graffiti piece or letters, it's a language within itself as a culture where it's illegible to most people, but you're kind of amongst your peers, you're wanting to show how much different styles you can do, still being legible, the different techniques. And from that learning, I put it into my painting work, where I didn't want to be recognised for an image. I want to be kind of unrecognised for what I did. I want people to find a painting where they wouldn't recognise it as a named person, they just like it for the art. It's easy to kind of come up with an iconic image and just repeat it hundreds of times to become recognised. I wasn't about that. I was about me personally wanting to just be creative and constantly push myself and change different styles and just as a personal thing. And then one day I got an email from, I don't know who it was now, well, another kind of artist at the time, saying, oh, we've seen what you do with your free art. Is it right if we do that as a group thing?
Mm.
And it was a real kind of dilemma at the time. I was doing this, and now someone's come along wanting to do it as well. I can't say no. It's like, what? Who am I to stop people from doing this? Yeah. I've got to kind of go along with it and go, yeah, of course you can do it. And then it became a kind of a thing called Finders Keepers, where they'd set up group events where people would meet up and give away free art. And I thought, oh, well, I don't know, I just got to keep doing it. I've started doing it for myself, I want to keep doing it. But they kind of lost interest and did other things anyway, so I kind of persevered with what I believed in. But it taught me a lot in terms of the bigger picture of the art world. It's not just the individual, it's the it's the movement of, like you say, the conscious evolution of everything, the visual language and stuff. And you can't stop things from happening. But I think in my way of working, you've got to just keep pushing forward with what you believe in, be it creatively or your language or your styles or...
I wondered if you could talk about a couple of works in the show that express the difference, perhaps, between a type of subject which is personal to you and one which is less personal. And I'm guessing that, for example, the couple with the kind of the pushchair walking down the street, I mean, that's, there's something universal about that. There may be something personal for you about that. Did you choose that as a subject matter which was so pervasive that you could almost see whether it would break apart just through the sheer boringness of that activity? Maybe this is a chance to kind of expand on this, what you say in the leaflet, that you wanted to venture outside your comfort zone to paint things you would not normally paint. I mean, I'm guessing that Adam Neate wouldn't normally paint a pushchair and a couple walking on the beach.
True.
So
I think, like, I am a naturally tormented person. My life is constant torment. I hate living. I hate this world. It's a complete just, oh.
You're enjoying this talk though, aren't you?
Oh yeah, loving it. So I would paint screaming heads till the cows come home. I just want to do that all day long, really. But I know as an artist, you have to push yourself. You have to try different things. It's like a self-discovery as an artist. You have to push forwards with things you haven't done before. Otherwise you just repeat yourself. I see creativity. This sounds cheesy now, but it's the only analogy I can come up with. It's like the flow of water. So you've got the water's constantly got to be flowing, like creativity. It goes down one path or goes another way, as long as it's flowing.
Matsubashu, that is very profound, actually.
Oh, is it?
Continuity and change.
The essence of being an artist is creativity, to create, to give birth to a creation, to make something from nothing, something which didn't exist before. Even if you maybe have to reference things from the past or overlap things or whatever, something new has to come from what you're doing. If you find yourself repeating yourself, it's not worth doing, for me personally. I mean, maybe other artists, it's their concept to repeat themselves, but for me, it's not being creative, so. Mm.
When you dimensionalize a couple walking along with a pushchair, are you trying to bring dimensional poetry to this very prosaic activity? Is that the idea?
Yeah.
Is that the experiment?
Yes.
To see whether it's possible to poeticise that.
Yeah. I mean, I keep a lot of sketches. I'm always sketching. I sketch from life. Anything I see, I write it down or constantly sketching. And I'll sketch sketches and keep sketching compositions, and stuff will stay in my head for years. Mm. Whereas it was just like it's a cathartic thing. I've got to do this image eventually until the style comes where now I can do that image. I've worked it out or... Mm. Something about the language of it is the time to do it. Mm. And that one, it was more of a kind of, I was in the realm now of painting my life and what I see as a day-to-day thing and how what I can capture within my, just the, like you say, the blandness of existence. Mm. Stuff still happens and you can poeticize on something, even if it is just walking.
And then with the big cardboard piece at the end, as I'm sure everybody has seen, you kind of poeticise in a kind of wry way, this with this monumental Matisse-like kind of cardboard nude on the beach, taking a selfie. And then within the screen, you've done a little kind of miniature Adam Neate. So she sees herself as an Adam Neate. You know, she dimensionalises herself.
Yeah.
I like that. I think it works really well.
Well, that was another one. I was sat on the beach with my coffee and my sketchbook, trying to come up with ideas. And then a busload of like exchange kids just turned up in a coach and all ran onto the beach. And the first things they were doing was taking photos of themselves with a pier in the background. And this one girl pulled about 12 different positions, like used to, you know what I mean? And it was just like, oh my God, that's 20 paintings for me just now, all these kids. Like just doing this, like you say, it was like a Henry Moore, this sculptural forms with a phone. Mm. And this generation of kids are so self-conscious of how they, their alter ego, they appear, plus the background, composing themselves. Mm. It was just like, I've got to do that, you know. This one girl looked like a sculpture, how she had it. Just, you're accentuating your body to get as much of yourself in, so at the same time, your body stretching for yourself to this kind of narcissistic, I don't know, it's fascinating.
It sounds to me like you're almost saying that this image bank that you carry within yourself, when you see it exterior to you, when you suddenly see it and it crystallizes in front of you, it's summoning up somehow this image bank within you, and then you're seeing it now. And you're combining that kind of memory impulse with this kind of nowness of the reaction to that thing that you're seeing there now, sculpturally, viscerally. Mm. And this is what Bergson talks about. And I think everybody, every good philosopher should be returning to Bergson and thinking about the way he very clearly explains this in imagistic terms. In 1896, where he makes this distinction in memory and the way that memory works between an image-based perfected memory, a pure memory as he calls it, that's within us of whatever it is, a bottle on a table or a woman on a beach. And we mix that with the present tense experience of seeing that thing now. And this is a very powerful visual mixture, he argues, which is about different synapse connections in the brain, is the way we would explain it now, but using two different parts of the brain to create a very, very strong sense of image. And I think, you know, there's a Bergsonian way of understanding Adam Neate. So I'm applying for the PhD now.
Can we talk about the chess player? Because that seems to have so many levels to it and so many hidden elements to it. Which you actually, you mentioned the fact that Duchamp had decided to be a chess player after he'd finished.
That's a kind
being
of
an artist.
A homage to him, really. After he did the urinal piece, if you know about the urinal piece, basically anything can be art. There you go. What do you do after that? Once anything could be justified as being art, he became a chess player. And wrote a book called The Art of Chess. So he kind of, you know, saw chess as an art form, if you like. I'm going to go into one now, I'll tell you. But anyway.
It is an art form.
Yes. Within that piece, it's kind of a homage to him. But also, it's like you're saying about the subconscious thing, where I'd always envisaged going to New York and seeing a couple of guys playing chess in Central Park. You know? I never found that image of the chessboard, but in my mind, in my consciousness, it was trees, yellow cabs, people playing, you know, that symbolism of New York. But within dimensionalism, I was playing about as well, where I wanted to create the overlap of the, instead of the traditional two-point perspective of the foreground and the background, I want to overlap the background with the foreground in a language where as you move around it, the bus in the background was turning right, and it also kind of overlapped in the foreground person's face. He's pressed stop on this move. He's just moved. He's pressing stop. He's had his move. It's the next guy's go. Mm. Relating to the background where the traffic signal's gone red. So the two people on the interchange are stopping, waiting to cross the road, which are also chess pieces, whilst the bus turns, which is a kind of a distorted sculptural form as you move around, it actually turns, where you're breaking down the background forms into kind of simplified colours and shapes to represent space and form in relation to the foreground, where it's more detail and colour and painterly.
That's a hell of a complicated image.
Load of stuff
going on. I mean, there is so much stuff in there.
And there's symbolism as well, It's kind of about proxy wars, really, and how the world goes about itself with, you know, organised conflict, if you like. It's like a big game of chess. And, you know, within the other guy's head, if you turn around, there's a tank, which is also in the road in the background, but as part of his head, is the painted of his earlobe. As part of his head, the tank is firing a a shell through that guy's head behind him towards the other guy. Anyway, yes.
That goes on and on. I mean, we must be very cautious if it makes comparisons with other artists, but I mean, I don't know about you, I saw a lot of Otto Dix, New German Realism, in some of your works. And also, I hate to say this, because he's not fashionable, but Stanley Spencer. I mean, he rears his head.
I'm a big fan of both of them.
Well, there you are.
Stanley Spencer as well. I think I've talked to you.
Totally English eccentric. English eccentric.
Well, yeah, definitely. I mean, I'm not living in his way, but in terms of an artist, capturing your life and how you live and what you experience and, you know, the environment, if you like. And just in terms of his compositions,
Which are a bit like yours, actually, in some respect.
I remember the day I said to Adam, you know, have you ever looked at Stanley Spencer? And I think it's something to do with the kind of the quotidian becoming mysterious. So in Stanley Spencer, I don't know if anybody saw the paintings which were his response really to his experience in the First World War that were shown recently at Somerset House. So we got a chance to see them all in one room in London, which was wonderful. I just have this enduring image of, this is someone who went through the First World War, and he immortalises it in jam sandwiches. It's powerful, that quotidian togetherness of the comfort of jam sandwiches and that slight slight bleeding between the bread, you know? There's something kind of horrific about it and comforting at the same time.
For these works in particular, why are these not sculptures anymore? Now that they do have this extra dimension, or the extra two dimensions, why are they not sculptures?
Good question. I think initially when I'm working my head with my sketchbook, I'm sketching compositions as paintings, as a how it would fit in a rectangular space. I mean, some pieces I have done where they haven't had, you know, that kind of, it's just a random abstract shape on the wall. I'm still in the mindset of a painter, but trying to kind of accentuating as much as possible what could be a paint brush stroke, but just bringing it out. I don't know. I mean, before this show, the past few years I was working in kind of a materialism sense where it was using different materials like chrome and perspex and you name it, throwing it all into the mix to just create kind of a different look and feel for myself. But at the same time, it's so open-ended. You're right, it could have ended up going down that path. People like Frank Stella or something where it just became, it would kind of merge into more sculptural stuff. Whereas I've still come from the painterly where it's kind of from the heart, the head or whatever to the hand of the expression, that the brush stroke. So it's still within there for me somehow. So I still see them as paintings really. I mean, I never say never to stuff, but at the moment with abstraction, it's just not stimulating enough as a thing. I feel you have to have that kind of, well, from at the moment how I'm working, I like that human element where a human can look at an image and there's another human in it, or that relation between that. I mean, who knows, one day I might go into abstraction, but at the moment I'm not in that mindset for it really. And apart from, you know, as you move around it, some pieces do go into abstraction.
Yes, they do.
But they kind of tie back into
figurative. They flip back into the figurative, yeah. So it does work in that way.
So I'm there at the moment with that.
Talked a bit about the disorientation of the viewer, the balance between abstraction, figuration, etc. What's next? I guess kind of in relation to the sculpture question, what's next in terms of space?
It's a funny one because I was talking to you about this earlier, about with going back 100 years, the advent of photography. When photography came about, there's no real reason for a traditional painter to paint a family portrait anymore when it could be photographed. So painters had to think of something else what the camera couldn't capture anymore. They had to paint around photography, so it gave birth to modern art with cubism and all the new isms and the expressionism to paint what the camera couldn't capture. And it's the same now with the new media of the internet, where there's no real need to go to an exhibition anymore. You can stay in, wake up the next morning and look at it online to see what was there. How can a modern painter paint around that medium to paint something which can't be captured digitally, online, or on film? to have people to actually physically come and experience the work where you wouldn't normally see it online. You'd have to go and see other elements to it, either the textural side of it or the materials used or something from the side of it or the back of it, or it might be animatronics involved or video or extra elements to kind of combat the technology of the now to make it still stimulating for people to regard it as interesting. So it's that kind of constantly trying to add to that stimulus within the work to
the senses. Yeah.
The senses, yeah. I mean, you know, you've got 3D cinema now, so you know, you're going to have it on the phones in the next 10 years, I reckon, 3D projections. People are going to be accustomed to that dimensional language in terms of how they perceive, you know, space and how it's how people communicate through it.
How do you extrapolate the fact that you're an artist primarily with the fact that obviously you're now a very commercial artist and originally you were producing work for yourself from a very different angle? How do you work through that thought process?
I think you just got to kind of still paint what you want to paint and don't pander to a market or other people's ideas. You've still got to have that integrity, I think, kind of, you know, I don't have an assistant, I don't get people to do paintings for me. I paint from within myself to paint paintings. It still is a kind of a personal thing for me. I try not to pander too much, you know. I'm locked away for a year working. Got no idea what people are going to think of it until, you know, it's shown. And so, whereas before on the streets, it was a very kind of, it was left for free, where I was trying to kind of separate the art from the monetary value to kind of, just as an experiment to see, you know, can people value art as art itself without thinking the worth of it? If it's left there for free, do you want it? Or you can walk past it, or... And so, but then human nature and humans will always profit from other people. So, you know, people would put it on eBay and try and get some kind of monetary value for it and what have you. So from that lesson, it's like, it doesn't matter. You just got to paint for yourself. And if people like it, that's a bonus. And if they want to buy it, you know, I'm pleased if they like it as well.
Probably in your show a couple of years ago with your boxer and the cyclists, you kind of hinted at this work. Those works seem to be a bit of the start of what we're seeing today. So if we come to your show in, say, 3 years' time or 2 years' time, how do you see that now in terms of... You're probably already working on kind of next year's and moving on again. Where would you see that going?
Seriously, I wish I could plan ahead. I don't know. I just work to a point when...
You've exhausted it.
Exhausted it and changed again.
Yeah.
Actually, you're the best person to answer that, because in 3 years' time, you'll come back and you'll say, well, this was the start of that thing that's happening now. It's the somebody else. It's the viewer, isn't it? No, but I do. Don't you think? I mean, it's the viewer in the end that adds so much to a work of art. You know, this is if you want to get into the kind of really the philosophy of modern art, and you look at someone like Donald Judd, for example, who said, coming back to the point about sculpture, Donald Judd was saying in 1965, you know, when are we going to get rid of this idea of the kind of rectangular picture? I predict that everything in the future will neither be painting nor sculpture. It will be dimension. It will be a specific object which is dimensional, and it may be on the wall, it may be on the floor. And that was a correct prediction. There's a kind of philosophy in modern art that says the work, in a way, doesn't exist until the viewer is there.
Yes, I just wanted to know if you had ever thought about making your artworks a bit participatory. So like the impulse I had when I saw your artworks for the first time was I really wanted to touch it and change it and, you know, play around with it. I was pretty happy they were behind glass here. And because I also thought, like, after all these questions that we heard, it would resolve quite a few of the issues. I mean, obviously, if you have to participate, then it's not enough to look at it through the internet. So it's this, what you just described, saying that how can a painter still influence or make people come to the exhibition? Also, it would add another dimension. So it would be like the fifth dimension, which is participation. And in terms of mathematics, I mean, what you're doing right now is basically you have a system of four equations that you can solve with four variables, and you would add another equation that just remains unsolved. So even mathematically, it's the next step. So the question, I mean, it's pretty logic, but but what does the artist think about this approach?
No, it's I
must admit, if I had questions like that, I think I'd walk out. That is
it's definitely a new thing. I did it a few years ago where I did the London show where I gave away 1,000 paintings around the streets. People kind of could use social media to communicate and go out and find where it was and become part of the event. You were part of the experience, if you like. It is definitely part of the way of thinking now. You know, I had one of a cashier where I had a cashier on the wall with like a pen hanging off the desk. There's a set of ropes in front like you would have in a bank, if you like. There's that fine line between that and installation art, whereas for me the installation thing is it goes back to the Duchamp thing of, you know, it could be anything really. It's how you kind of bring it back, home it back into something which was created for a purpose more contained, say, within in a wall space, but still could be an installation, if you like. And that participation element could be involved with that. It's possible.
I wondered, out of this show or one of your previous shows, if there's any one piece that you could particularly specify where you think that the techniques and the process that you went through was more challenging and the end result was more, you know, that was a more positive experience for you as an artist, not necessarily the one that, you know, was the most popular in for other people.
You got to have that struggle. Well, for me personally, if you're not struggling, you're not pushing yourself enough. You know, if it comes too easy, you're not doing anything what you haven't done before or worth doing. So you've got to have that torment with what you're doing to resolve it, to get to the other side where you battle and you win, or you learn something, or you answer a question within what you're doing. We start off with questions, you try and answer them within the work. There's like the horse racing one, horses. I don't go to the bookies all the time. I'm not a massive horse fan, but just as to push myself with a subject matter where, you know, where as opposed to not being figurative, something else, like, you know, animal based, right, how can I do this, what can I set myself to do? And I grew up in Dedham, which is a village near Colchester, and it was the home of Sir Alfred Munnings, who's a famous horse painter. So I had that on me to think, well, if I'm going to try and do horses, I can't be as good as him. He is the horse painter. You can't paint a better horse than this guy. How can I put my angle on it as best as I can do it with my language? So I had all that pressure to try and create something and do something I wasn't used to, and it was like just a load of work I set myself. And it's interesting with the sculpture pieces, because you start off doing it and you're halfway through, and then you have that, you lose your confidence with that lack of self-belief. You get to the point where, oh, what am I doing, is this right? And you have to kind of go through that barrier to persevere, to try and finish something where it's not like a traditional painting where you can just wipe it off and start again. You've built something already, and you're like, you won't know the result until you've finished it. So it's a quite a interesting process, this work, like that. So that's one of them, the horse one, yeah.
Adam, I think you've done incredibly well, because these were very, very difficult questions. I mean, it's a great show, and as I say, it's doing extremely well. And Adam, I think the next thing is a museum show for you somewhere.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I think you've got to be dead to be in a museum.
I think fair enough, fair enough. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.